audience engaged for full immersion.
The world's most immersive movie experience begins now.
So really appreciate you coming back. Thank you so much.
Glad to be here.
Awesome. So what I wanted to do is I've sort of gone back through our first sort of part one, and obviously, you know, speaking to you, I get excited, and I've always got something to say, as my friends say. So I probably came in at certain points, and just before we get on past sort of the Mars and Sirius, and I think we should definitely cover a little bit more about the Mars and the Sirius piece before we sort of sporadically move on, right? I just wanted to maybe just go back through the things that we spoke about last time and ask you some direct questions specifically about some areas that maybe we skirted over and I just wanted to go back into. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure. Go for it.
So, obviously, there's this whole area of proof, right? And obviously, that was one of the first things that we got into. And like you said, proof is proof. I'd like to just sort of hear from you how you're going to go about bringing that proof to the people.
Well, what happened to me was, as I remembered things that would have proved it, you know, there were things that I remembered that I could have said to somebody in the beginning when I first got my memories back. I could have said that to somebody, and then somebody else would have came forward and said it too, and it matched up. But it was like every week on certain shows, people were disclosing things. There were other whistleblowers talking about things that I had just remembered. And it was like I got beat to the punch, like the easy proof, the low-hanging fruit of things that were provable or things that weren't common, things that I experienced, that everybody else experienced up there, that I could have spoke of and been the first one to do so, would have proven me, you know, would have given a lot of validity to me. That low-hanging fruit just was gone. Like, it was like every week, and there was nobody for me to talk to. Nobody was listening to me that first 6 months, you know, it was 3 to 6 months, I think, before I really got a hold of anybody. That was the easy proof. The other thing is the earthbound proof. So that was actually big when I went to Seattle. That proved it to me. You get what I'm saying? Like, I'm not on a mission I'm not on a big mission to tell people about this. I just had to deal with it. It was big to me, and I was having a hard time dealing with it. I wanted to talk to other people that may have gone through the same thing. So that's why I came out. That's the whole deal.
Yeah, because you needed to express it, right? You needed to get it out of you.
Well, right? I didn't believe it myself. There were things, you know, I had visuals of E.T. sitting on a train with me, or me on a spaceship and having a life, you know, like as a slave in a Star Trek quality, know what I mean? Like, I had those memories. Yeah. I had those memories in a reality, and I'm going, these are memories. This isn't, you know, it was not a dream. A dream, like I say it all the time, a dream, you don't know how you got there, and you don't know how you went home. These are memories. I know how I got there that day, and I know how I went home, where I went home to. I can remember chronologically going home and going back to bed, all the way to bed. Many times that I, you know, was sad, whatever. I wanted to prove that to myself, and Seattle did that. When I went and found the house where I lived, basically from, I want to say, 86. It was like 85 to 86 or 87, those years in there. I got to go back and it's been so long since I looked at my own timeline. But it was like 86, 87. I was there at that house, and a lot's changed, but a lot's the same. Like, I was driving around in that neighborhood, and I went, wow, that's new. I was spotting out things that the gas stations that had been expanded on, and like, I knew that stuff. It was
Let me just ask. So this time period in 86, and when you were having these Earth memories, can you just put that into context, into how that fits into this whole? Was this before or after the alien, the Greys have come and visited you, and you've been taken to Peru? Is this before?
It was right after Peru. It was right after Peru.
Okay.
So in Peru, they were, you know, they had trained me for whatever the remote viewing, the CIA stuff. It was offshoot of Grow Flame. It was like remote viewing. And
let's hit this now then. So rather than us going, so I didn't know the timeline, right? So now I know that this was after Peru. Let's hit the Seattle thing. after the Peru thing, right? So my next question that I wanted to come back to you on was it that you, so you were taken away and you were tested on, right? And this was, so your initial contact was with the Greys, and the Greys told you they wanted to borrow your consciousness, right?
Yeah, I was taken to some base somewhere. I think it was an underground base somewhere. I don't know where. It was kind of rounded rooms and gray, you know, like stone rooms. But I couldn't see very good. I had bad poor eyesight, and I didn't have my glasses. So I don't have a clear memory. I remember seeing that room blurry. I was there, and then that was the whole deal was made. They want to borrow my consciousness. Then they did a procedure on me. There was a needle that went in right behind my dominant eye.
Okay.
And bam, it was like I saw stars, and I woke up. I lost consciousness, and I woke up without any memory of what just happened. And I was like, had amnesia, and I was in Inyo Kern Air Base.
And how old was you now?
I would have been 10 years old. So 10 years old, and that was the very beginning. And I went through like a brutal MK Ultra trauma-based mind control program. And I don't know how long it lasted, 3 months, 6 months. Honestly, I don't know how long it lasted. I'm trying to get a better bearing on that for the book. But I went through that, and then I was shipped to Peru. I went to Seattle, to their house in Seattle, the guy that owned me, and I was there, and I witnessed them performing ritual satanic stuff, you know, human sacrifice.
This is in Peru, right?
No, this was in Seattle at the house. I went from Inyo Kern to the house in Seattle.
They tested
and then
you
I was there for a couple weeks.
And they brought you back. Got you. Okay, I'm with you now.
Well, Inyo Kern was like a training. Like, they put me through mind control training, and, you know, and it was the psychic stuff. That was that. And it was like remote viewing and other stuff that I wasn't conscious for. They would drug us to near death, and they could use us to talk to other entities, I believe. That's my best guess.
Yeah.
Channeling, but on an industrial grade level.
So this is something that you're going to try and go back to and try and remember more detail on for your book. And
I found plenty of evidence about the program.
This is our document that we discussed, right?
Yeah.
This is the document.
Well, that document is an offshoot of that program. So that was all funded under one, Project Stargate, and I think there was a Gateway project. Gateway. Grill Flame, and a few others. They were all under the same funding. They all were offshoots of the same funding. So there's paperwork. There's declassified paperwork about all that.
Which we've talked about. Shared. Yeah, I've seen this.
Yeah, and I've got
to prove that because I've been on the CIA website and I've found everything you've showed me, right?
Well, so what's funny is the cast of characters of people, which I'm not named, but that I found, I remember them. The cast of characters, I was able to find they did have a doctor that had extensive experience in sleep deprivation and MK Ultra programming.
This is the doctor that
I connected that. I'm still researching. Still researching everything. But they had a doctor involved in that program that's documented. You can find on the CAA. These documents are public knowledge, and I connected that program, the Grill Flame program, with the MK Ultra and the sleep deprivation that I called out back in 2016. So I've just found this info. So that's kind of a proof. It's still shaky. I mean, no one can prove that I didn't go and research it earlier, but I didn't. You know, I'm still turning this stuff up just now. Anyhow,
okay.
I've proven that existed, you know, and I haven't connected it to Inyo Kern, but that's for later. Anyhow,
before you go on, what I can tell you definitely is all of those things in that document are things that I've actually gone away now. I've gone and researched the Monroe Institute. I've downloaded many of his exercises, and since I last spoke with you, I've actually gone through that process of lesson 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 with Bob Monroe, right? And I can tell you now, yeah, this is a powerful, powerful program, man. And the balancing of the hemispheres of your mind, it happens as soon as you listen to these tapes with Bob, right? So I just wanted to bring that to you that what the information you're bringing to me, I'm not just taking that information and going, okay, Tony said it means it's real. I'm actually going to go away and I'm going to test this scenario, right? And I'm doing that now. So we'll keep talking about that as we go through. So but please carry on.
At the end of the MK Ultra stuff, at the end of that, when they discovered that, when they tested us and we tested for the theta programming, which was psychic stuff, when they found psychic ability in us, the kids in that class, then we went on to the Gateway stuff, and there were people from the Monroe Institute there helping them do it. They had headphones, and they laid us down, and we went through those tapes back then. I remember the damn put everything in the box part. Here's the thing, the heavy lid, afterwards, so everything we did got debriefed. Everything we did when we were done at the end of the day, he would call one at a time into the office, into his office, and debrief us and say, what did you feel about that? How did you feel? How did it work for you? You know, he wrote everything down. It was a scientific process they were doing. And the box was, he said, I want you guys to describe the box. What was your personal box that you made? And mine was like a cooler, like a steel. Mine looked like a cooler, you know, like my box. And there was another kid that said, I made mine out of diamonds. Oh. And everybody was like, hey, and I was so jealous of him. I remember that, being jealous. So then when I heard the Monroe stuff again, I found the in stuff. I went on YouTube and got a free one, and he was like, just got put everything in your box. And I went, oh my God, all that stuff came back to me then. That's when that whole scene came back, you know? And I was like, oh wow. You know, like, so I mean, that's just another one of those instances. Like, I keep looking for things that would split from what I remember. It just helps. Everything just supports what I remember. I keep finding circumstantial evidence and bits and pieces on top of visiting Seattle, on top of finding physically the house. That's exactly how I remember it. The road's exactly how I knew my way around the road. I could drive. I could prove, because my family knows, that I was never there. I had my family with me all through the 80s. I have witnesses that I never went to Seattle, not once in those years, but I know my way around that island of Seattle. I shut off Google Maps at one point, and I found the quickest route to the house, like the back of my hand. I knew that island. I knew my way around to the house. I know the little store. The candy is still on sale at the store. I knew the beach. I went there. I knew where rocks were around the corner. We used to throw rocks at each other. She took us down to this one beach by the lighthouse there. So I proved it to myself, which is why I'm still here.
Yeah, and what you're saying is proof now. It's the natural ability to be able to describe something, and those things that you can see, I can see that you're saying to me that you don't make this up, right? And this is just to give you feedback. This is the people that I've had a preliminary watching of this video. They've all said it's genuine because you can't make this up, right? And carry on, dude. So right. Seattle, let's get into this. So let's get into this.
I spent one day there in 2016. I think it was September of 16. I flew there. We moved from Hawaii back to Michigan, and everybody went ahead of me, and then I went to Sacramento and to Mount Shasta and then back, and I spent the night in Seattle and then drove through, or I spent the day on that island and flew out, and because I had to see it for myself. And it was just exactly, and the memory that I had of it was freakishly accurate. And I remember living there years. I remember new boys coming and going in that home, and every time somebody new came, we said the same thing, that, you know, because they didn't know where they were. Where am I? That's what everybody would say. We're like, how long do you think it's going to be before he asks where he's at? And they would come in, and it'd be an hour. Some guys were a half hour. Some boys were as soon as they got there, and some never asked. But everybody always pretty much asked, where am I? And we would say, you're in Washington State, not Washington, D.C. And she didn't want us to tell the island name. But some boys she did. She would tell them what island. I don't say it publicly because I don't want people to go track it down yet. But I've had people figure it out. I've had people contact me, and they figured out bits and pieces of my interviews, and they put it together, who it was. Anyhow, I proved it to myself with that. The other thing is, I have not been to Peru. I will go through the same experience if I visited that town in Peru. Yeah. I would go through that same experience if I visited another town in Peru. That I've talked about very rarely, but that I visit, that I remember going there. And I think that if I visited the airstrip in Inyokern or China Lake in that area, I'll go through the same kind of experience where I can describe things accurately for somewhere that I've never been. So that would make me a pretty good trickster, you know, in that regard. If I can tell you what the inside of a building looks like that nobody has public knowledge of, and I've never been there, and I can instantly prove it. And I can tell you, go inside there, the bathroom's over there, and the office is in the back, and we used to sleep right here.
Unless people say that you're a very good psychic and you can astro project into those places.
I wish. That'd be great. But,
but that's just me. That's just me just screwing with you, man. Don't worry.
Well, that would be good, too. You know what? If I could do that, Yeah. That'd be a great trick. Then that's worth. That's definitely worth YouTubing.
Let me tell you right now. Let me tell you right now. We can all do that, Tony. But that's fine. It's about whether or not we know how to do it, right? So okay, look. Let's not get touching. Let's not go too deep now on the proof. I think I get you right. And the point is that we're going to get into the Sirius and the Mars, and we're going to go to those places. And obviously, the same is viable, right? Is that how are you going to know?
One other piece of proof that I had my fingers crossed, but recently the Dawn probe, that's the NASA probe that was around, sent to Ceres and went around it, and it's recently died. It ran out of fuel, and it's a dead probe. And I was hoping that the geyser would go off. The bright spots on Ceres in that crater, the O'Connor crater, are remnants of magnesium and other chemicals that the water shoots up out of a geyser, and then that stuff snows back down. And there's piles of it there. There's tons and tons of it there. From the water evaporates and leaves the chemicals that's in the water there. And so I was hoping that geyser would go up while the probe was there, because I called it out in like 2015 that was a geyser. I remember flying across it when it was going off. And I remember that back then that they said the geyser goes off randomly every 6 to 9 years. And NASA originally saw a water event around Ceres. Like, they thought they picked up water, and so they sent the Dawn probe out. And the probe's dead now before the geyser went back off. So that would have been proof. If a geyser is discovered on Ceres in the future, I called it out in 2015 and said exactly where it was and why. Because I remember flying over it and looking at it. It's one of those sites that you don't forget.
Sure.
It was one of the most beautiful things. They let us all take off of work, leave our stations, and go to a window and watch it, because it was a beautiful thing and it was rare. So we all, and then they went out of their way. The other coincident thing, I'll send you this map of Ceres. I remember flying across it, and I took a picture and I drew the flight path, because I remember looking at the geyser came from right to left, you know, as we flew over it, and I looked down. So then I remember where the entrance was to the base, and I thought, I wonder if we were on the way. And sure enough, the direction from the geyser coming right to left, where we were exactly how I remembered it, is just like a slight curve, and it went right to where the entrance of the base was that I also remembered at the, they called it Pyramid Base. It's at the Auhanna Mons. There's a big crater there that had an entrance to the hangar bay. And that's where we flew into. I witnessed that on one occasion where I was on the bridge of the ship. So, it again, it's a circumstantial thing, but they just keep adding up. It just never quits. Every time I go and research something that I remember, yeah, it fits. And it, you know, it's, and I'm the only one that does it. I don't have the money to go out professionally and do this. And I think a lot of stuff would have been proven already if people did have money and time and money to go and do this. But, you know, it would cost me a lot of money, and it would be a big deal to learn Spanish and get a crew together and go down to Peru, you know, and prove this and prove it. It'd be a big deal. And I just, I don't have the resources for that at this time in my life.
Uh-huh. Carry on, dude. Great. And so let's talk then. So we're going to move on, and we're going to talk about this time in. So we've clarified then that we went to Peru. We went into this. You went through this mind, techniques with these guys in Peru, which was this doctor that you've now discovered.
In Peru, so they, when we finished that, I went to that house. They did their satanic stuff. In Seattle. I went from Inyo Kern, went through a psychic class, the MK Ultra stuff, like a class, like training. And then went to Seattle, and it was like a week or two there, and they did satanic stuff. I saw a child get sacrificed, and they did a couple other ceremonies with us, and it was weird. Yep. And then after that, he had a private plane on his property, picked me up and flew me. We went to Texas and stayed the night. I stayed right on the plane, and then the next morning we got up and we flew to Peru, and they dropped me off at Puerto Tuantinsuyo with a suitcase full of these drugs and with IVs that they were putting in me, and a manual. Like, I had a manual, and I was something that was sold to there. And that was a shipping point. They were bringing cocaine up the river and piling it up every few days. Somebody would come and drop off on one of those long boats, those long canoes, drop off cocaine, and they stocked it up. And when they had so many pounds, they filled it up in an airplane. And they had lost an airplane previously, So that's why I was there. I was like an early warning system. If there was police or bad weather or they got lost, they said that they could put me, drug me, and figure out what was going on, and like an early warning kind of thing. That's what I was. I was like a psychic radar. And that happened, and we went on flights about every month. It was like once a month. And that went on for like 2 years that I did that. And when I got close to puberty, I started losing whatever the ability. Like, the guy that put me under was my handler. He was the only one that could speak English in the whole town. And so he was stuck with me. He hated the job. But when he put me under, there were times when I woke up that he was just like blown away, because he said he was talking to his dead grandma. He said that people were telling him stuff about, he had questions that from people in the town that he wrote down and asked me. And I was like a professional psychic that they had.
Yeah.
And so that's what happened. So when I got to about 13, or right before 13 years old, I started losing the ability when I hit puberty. And so they sent me back to Seattle, and I ended up living there for a couple of years. And
in the same place in Seattle?
Same house, yeah. Yep.
Right.
Okay. And then he was having boys in, so he was running the pedo-gate stuff. It was, and I also, there was no pedo-gate in the news. There was no Hillary's emails or any of the pedo-gate stuff when I came out with this. And I had already said about this, that they were running an underground with boys. And I was the first person, I think, that came out that connected any kind of Satanism to a space program or the pedo-gate stuff. And we were being sold. They were throwing parties. They were throwing your eyes wide shut parties, and we would get drugged up and they'd rape us. And that's what happened. And it wasn't like you would think that a sex slave, like the girls get it, where they're doing 12 hours a day every single day. The boy, it was rare. It was 3 or 4 times a year that they did this to us. And there were boys that came and went that got sold, that traded in and out. You know, there was a core of like 5 boys that never left, and there were another 5 boys that came and went. Yeah, I at the end of my service, at the end of that tour, I did not want to forget the people that I had known. I had become close with people, and specifically a woman that I was in love with, and I didn't want to forget her. And so I ingrained it into my mind. It was like I remember they flew us on a disc from Ceres to the moon during the return. And I remember there was a round room at the upstairs at the top of the disc. They had windows, and there were, I don't know, nine of us maybe, going back. It was grimy. It was like, it wasn't some fancy thing. It was like carpet, and it was grimy. It was a grimy, dirty, public transport kind of transport, you know.
But it was a round disc. Room.
It was a disc. Yeah, it was a, right. Yeah. Yep. And it had a round couch that went around it, and then there was a big carpet in the middle. You could just sit down on the floor. But I remember pacing back and forth. I'm not going to forget. And the guys, there were guys on the other slaves that were going back to telling me to shut up, man, knock it off. And we talked, and I remember telling them about it. You know, like, I'm not going to forget this. They're not going to erase my memory. And I was combative the whole time. And one guy was a black guy, which I didn't see very often up there. But he was a black guy. He came from an outer colony and stopped in at Ceres on his way back. He was on his way back, too. He was being reintegrated. And he said something rude to the pilot. Like, he was like, you know, F you. And I said, dude, you're going to get in trouble. He said, well, they can't do anything to us now. There's a law that says they got to get us back. What are they going to do, throw you in jail? They got to have us back. They wait till the last minute to put us back, and they have to. It's a law. So you're not gonna get in trouble for anything. And I saw him get away with it, and I tested it, and it was true. I started not cooperating. I took his advice, and I started not. I was combative through the whole process, and I did not want to forget. I didn't want to go through that. I didn't want to even leave. I didn't get to say goodbye. The last few days that somebody was there, especially the last day, to do his work for him.
Yeah,
he always did that. So when somebody was going home, we would take over their job so they didn't have to do anything that last day. That was custom. And I didn't get any of that. I didn't have anybody lined, no friends send me off, nothing.
That's great. So a couple of questions I just want to cover off. Something that we come across was that when you went into the 20 years and back program, what I want to understand before we move on is how much time had lapsed on this earth. We established between us when we talked last time that we believe that your consciousness was borrowed and put into another sleeve, and that's where you became a clone. And we believe that your other body, your carcass was left on the base, right? Yes. From the time that you woke back up and was readdressed into this body, which I'm assuming means you were back to being 10, right?
Yes.
From the time that you then left that base and was back with your family, to your family, how much time had elapsed?
Well, I went to bed at night, and it was later on, probably 11 or 12 midnight, maybe a little after midnight, that the abduction happened. You know, it was late, and I woke up the next morning at 7 a.m. Oh. I woke up and I went, you know, I felt changed. I felt different. I felt, what do you call it? I was 20
years older.
Well, I was shocked to see my room again.
I bet you were.
Woke up in my room and I was completely shocked. And you know what's funny is I started to notice, you know, there's that scene. That scene is in a lot of movies. Back to the Future, the first one, when he wakes up and he's back in his room and it's the same. He goes through that, yeah. Whoa, I'm back. That's that feeling. I went through that exact same feeling. When I woke up that morning, I remember looking out and looking through over my bed. My room was messy. You know, I had toys. And it was messy. And I remember looking over and I was totally unfamiliar with it. I went, well, this is my old room. And all my toys, and after that, I never played with any of those toys ever again. I used to play with my toys. And my mom even said that. It's funny. I'm just now remembering this. This is just now remembering. My mom said something to me a week or two later. Well, how come you never play with your toys anymore? Like, I quit playing. I used to play with my toys all the time. And I quit that day.
Of course you did. Because your mind has been stimulated so far past what a toy would be to anybody, that toys are meaningless to you now. Right. And that's the reality, right? And just to touch on this, Tony, and I don't want to talk too much about me, right? But there was a time, and I told you very briefly, and you and I will talk maybe in reverse, and we'll talk about what happened to me. But that feeling of this waking up, that consciousness, that readdressing into your physical body, I've experienced in it, and it, not for 20 years and back, man, but it's a strange thing, Tony. It's a strange fucking thing. Okay, cool. I don't want to get too caught up, right? So let's just talk. I want to get your opinion on the holograph theory from the document, and I'm going to not going to speak. I want you to tell me what you think from the document and what you've learned about this true, are we holographs, and how that holograph really works, and I'm going to let you speak. So go.
Okay, it's more than a mouthful. So last February, I was fortunate enough to be invited to speak at the Star Family Conference in Rye, Melbourne, Australia, south of Melbourne, Australia. And while I was there, I met a few other speakers, and Mary Rodwell, who is a very renowned researcher, I got to sit and talk to her, and she said that she was working with other physicists about the quantum holograph theory, and that there are guys that have really done their work on it, and there's some very big papers that are going to come out and be published at the colleges there that basically prove it, the quantum holograph theory. And what that does is it marries up all the physics with the psi abilities, because Mary is a person that's done great deals of research with children that have strange things, the children that wake up and have memories of life on Mars. So she had to explain that she's a scientific person, and she got with scientists and the physicists there in, I think, Sydney, the University of Sydney, I'm not sure. But, and it's quantum holograph theory. She said it explains everything. Quantum holograph theory works. It explains the ESP. It explains the telepathy. It explains all that stuff. And it explains the macro physics. It works with the physics. And what that document, so lo and behold, we turn up this document that the CIA had decades ago that goes off, and they're talking about it matter-of-factly, like they've already known it's been a hologram for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
The hologram, you know, stalking the pendulum, that document by that guy, I don't know how, where he got his info, but they use that as their basis for their research. And what it says is that on a very, very tiny level, at the smallest resolution level of our reality, everything's made up of just positive and negative energies, energy fields. Yes. Every little atom is not a thing. It's an energy field, and it's just positive and negative charge.
From my experience, Tony, I can classify and clarify that I know for a fact that the holograph theory is true, because I saw this world outside of my carcass, and I could see this world as a grid. I saw this, and I saw the energy around us, right? So that's why when you showed me that document, Tony, you know, the moment when you listen to the with the box, right? Mm-hmm. This that document, I'm like that. Whoa, like, I read that. I'm like, oh my God. And there's other things, right? The Thor the tablets of Thoth is another thing. I think you should listen to the tablets of Thoth, because you're going to experience some of the things he says in the tablets of Thoth. The Thoth tablets will bring you back to the experiences when you were in Peru.
The hermetic principle stuff supports it too. All of that stuff is supportive of it. The science of a hologram, now if you take an actual holograph, here's the thing, here's the principle that I'm still wrapping my head around. The science of a holograph is that one light beam of light gets split into two beams. And so the first beam doesn't really get split off. It's a natural beam. So you have a source and a beam that goes to it, then it gets split and bounces off of something. It has a event. A perturbedness, so the beam bounces off something, let's call it an apple, and then it bounces, goes back, and it's overlaid over the natural beam above it. Yeah. What happens is then you get your 3D effect. You get the apple that's 3D, but really it's just a two-dimensional beam. So what we've got is that the universe is a source. We have a source of energy that lays out over us, and we are the events. Your Correct. Life that you're going through, your life that you're going through, your consciousness is the bounce. You're turned into an apple. You turned into an asshole. You turned into somebody beautiful. You turned into a rock star. You turned into a homeless man.
Turned into what you want to be.
You turned into a
business. Be what you want to be.
Turned into a banker or a cook. You are that light that gets perturbed off the universe and comes back above the source light. And then we have that's you. And there's me, and you like, so that's how it's working, you know, but it's on a consciousness level. And of course, you know, there's time, space involved. There's time that it takes for things to develop, you know, it's a hologram. And so I'm sure I'm oversimplifying it, but basically the physics behind that and the principles behind that hold true. And so that hologram is mental.
Can I ask you, you said there's going to be some papers released in some university in Maryland. Is that where you said it was?
In Australia.
In Australia. And did you know the scientist that you said you were speaking about, her name?
Well, Mary is a researcher, and she was just telling me about that later. They may be out already. I haven't followed it. But she said that there was some very...
Maybe we can put this together, and maybe you and me can start talking. You can introduce me to her, and we can start... Because sure. This is really important to me. This aspect of what we're discussing... is really something that I want to hone into with
physicists are kind of in denial of any kind of new thing that takes them away from the math they've already, you know, you work 20 years on one math problem.
So you mentioned at some point you had an MRI scan.
Yes.
When did this happen, and why did this happen?
It was the last week of April of 2015. So I just having headaches, and I went to the doctor about it. It was a little weird to me. I was having headaches for like 6 months, you know, dull headaches on the back. Who knows what it was? I think it was my eyes, to be honest with you, that I was just getting headaches, and I worked in front of a computer screen all the time. So I went and got checked out. I asked the doctor about it, and she was like, well, probably nothing wrong. Let's just get a scan just to cross that out. You know, go ahead. We got one right here. And I spent that afternoon. I went over and I sat, and I didn't get the full ride MRI scan. They just scanned my head.
Okay.
And coincidentally, so I didn't think anything of it. Went on about my way. But it was 2 weeks later. It was 2 weeks after that I got the memories back. So I didn't put it together.
Shit.
It was 2 weeks later that when I talk about, I always had the memories, but it was 2 weeks after that I had the big where I went, holy shit.
This is because you mentioned this MRI to me, right? And there was something. There's something that. Okay. I'm a spiritual guy, right? And I've got a lot of guides, and I've got a lot of other dimensional beings that I speak to regularly. And one of the main things that I was told to ask you was about the MRI and the reason you had the MRI and what happened after the MRI. And You just said that to me. So I think that's an area for you maybe that's going to help.
The thing about the MRI is, so I didn't even think anything of it. But six months later, I think almost a year later, I read, somebody said, hey, you ever read the Mars records? I think it was Michael Rife. I'm saying his name wrong, but there were two guys. One of them did kinesiology, and he got memories back of living on Mars. And then another guy got an MRI and got memories back. And I went, hey, whoa, I had an MRI. And so I wasn't even thinking about it. I went, I read this. You know, I went to their website and I read it. I said, wow, he got an MRI and he got memories back of a 20 and back in Mars. And I went back and I looked at my online. I could look at my medical records. And sure enough, it was because I had wrote an email the day, a couple days after I got on.
I emailed people.
So I could track it down. I went, whoa, I got the MRI 2 weeks right before it happened. Right before I got the big recall. So,
there's power in this, Tony. And there's power in what happened, and there's power in being able to get more back.
I can't say that definitely that it was the MRI that got me my stuff back. But I can't say that's not. I have to say that, you know, looking back on it, coincidentally, that same couple weeks to 10 days apart, I had an MRI. You know, so that's worth knowing. That'd be useful to somebody.
Shit don't happen for no reason, right? It's called synchronization, dude.
The other thing that happened in that week was that I saw the Randy Kramer tapes that he did on ExoPolitics, and he explained the 20 years that he went through and explained how you do 20, and then they can put you back. He explained how that worked, the temporal time dilation, and so that's when I went. Also, that was a big realization for me to say, oh, wow.
It's a snap in your mind.
I had all these memories of Seattle, memories of being on the geyser. I always remember the geyser, but I couldn't figure out when. When did I do that? Because I always been me.
Where's the space, right?
And this, yeah, is exactly. That was years of stuff. I must have been a dream. That must have been a really killer, funky kind of dream for me to remember all that detail. What an awesome dream that is.
Yeah,
and I just think another. So when I saw the Randy thing, like, whoa, they took me for 20 years. And then I sat down and I internalized it. It all came. Once I accepted that, they all kind of came together like a broken picture, and it kind of started to come together and make details where I could see the picture better. I'm still putting it together.
Did you receive my thing I sent you about regression?
I did, but I didn't look into it. I haven't looked into it. I've had a pretty full plate these days.
When you've got time, man, it's there for you, and I know it works. Okay, so I everything I say to you, I will provide back to you because I've tested them, right? In the message I sent to you, I've tested past life regression for about a year, and I've probably tried 30 different techniques, and this one worked, right? So I've sent it to you. I want to touch on one more thing before we start. I'm going to go into Mars, and you talk to me about a lobby and that type of stuff, and I'm going to go there with you. Just one more thing before we go on, and I've got to ask you about about inner Earth. I've got to ask you about hollow planets. I've got to ask you about the fact that you've already told me that you've been inside planets. The fact that when we talked about Mars, you told me that you went into a dome under the ground, right? You said this to me already. So before we get into, and I'm going to talk to you about this dome under the ground because it sparked something in me. Like, we're going to talk about that. And before we do that, just talk to me about Hollow Earth and what you know about Hollow Earth and whether or not you traveled here and went into Hollow Earth and left.
We did. We were dealing with one of the inner Earth races. We would go in and there was a route that went half under the Earth and half underwater to Antarctica. And sometimes we would go there and pick up things and take them to Antarctica, drop them off, and then go.
Nordics or Draconians?
In the inner Earth. Antarctica was the Germans, was the German high command. It was the high command. We had to clean up everything in the ship. When we went there, we were subject to surprise inspections if we ever went to Antarctica, and everybody was stressed out, like the command crew.
So they were dealing with two races.
Yeah. So there was another race inside that.
On the Germans. We'll come back to them.
Well, it was in the Catarina Mountains in South America. There was a place. And I remember because it was a big ledge, it was a big stone ledge that was smooth. And we would park the ship on it, and the ship was 1,000 feet by 600 feet wide. So it was a big area. And I remember that you could look up and see a little bit of sunlight coming in, and there would be water sometimes coming down. You know, there's water coming down. And it was the side of a mountain, and it was in the Catarina Mountains. And the reason I remember that is because everybody was like, wait, we're right down the street from Peru. You know, yeah. And I was like, are we there? Are
we're
we
going
to Peru?
We're going back to the base? We're going to go back to the
And it was something like 1,500 miles away or, you know, 2,000 kilometers.
In a ship like that, that's minutes, right? That's not.
Yeah. So I was the one, because I had lived in Peru earlier, I was the only one that really lived to Earth time. Someone always said something when we went there, you know. They like ribbed me about it, you know, like, hey, we're in your old stomping grounds, you know.
What happened when you landed there? What did you deliver?
There was the race. So the Germans really didn't have the technology to fly through things. And these people that we were trading with did. And I want to say that they were blue, that they were light blue skin. Not what?
Bluebird people, not the blue
angels. Oh, no, they weren't birds. They were people. Okay. They were humanoid. They were tall. I met one time, and it's hard for the life of me. I can't remember his face.
This was in South America.
Yep.
And the
Germans, they would meet us there. They had a ship that would come. They could fly through the Earth. They could fly through solid objects, and they had a ship that would come and land. And it was round. It was a round like a cylinder. And they would pull up. So we would drop off cargo, and they would come and load it up, and vice versa. So they would give us cargo that they weren't allowed to take to other places.
Yeah, you was a middleman for them. You were taking them and dropping for them. Yeah, I get it.
They didn't have access to go everywhere in the solar system that we did, and we didn't have access to go everywhere that they did. And there were times we took high tech stuff that was theirs, and delivered it to other people.
So let me ask you. So you've got these blue like humanoid people in South America that you're visiting. They're flying from inner Earth. They're flying from inner Earth to you. You're dropping stuff off to them, and they're dropping, and you're taking stuff and taking them to other places for them as well, right? Okay. Now, I'm sorry that I've got a bit shocked about the Germans. It's just because I find it very hard. When I found this out, and I found out, and I know the disgusting things that have happened in the past, to know the powers that we know exist, the families, the network, everything that exists in this place today, still permit those people to be there in Antarctica, in inner Earth. So I want to talk about that now, and I want you to tell me what happened. You said that you went under the water sometimes into Antarctica, and they were the Germans.
I can remember, yeah. And it was the High Command. So that was where everything was ran from, all the German colonies in our solar system. As far as I know,
who you work for, right?
Yes. Yep.
That's it. So
the Ceres colony was under them, and they were under a Draco base that was around Jupiter in a time bubble, in a time dilation. There was a base, and when you went in, it was black. There was no stars. When you went inside, there was a bubble, and you went in it, and they had to go out of it the exact same way. There was a way that you would come out at the wrong time. It happened once. They screwed up, and we came out 16 hours before we went in it. And so we had to stand. We had to keep working. It was on top of a 10-hour day. It was a 16-hour.
But you understand that this is the race that have created our time lock. You understand that we're in a time lock, right? So they have the ability to be able to control time, and they have the ability to be able to create. So this is where there was a question I asked you off air about Valerium ore. And the Valerium ore is what we understand. So a couple of things. We're going to get back to the Germans, right? And we switched up quickly because we've come to Draconians, then we went to Jupiter. And I need to ask you a few things about whether you're aware of these things. So what we know is that at the moment, the moon has been colonized, as has Mars, as has most of these planets at the moment in our solar system that we know of, plus these star systems. We're past this. Between you and I, and many of our viewers of this video are probably going to say they're not past it, right? But that's fine. You and I are past this, okay? What we know is that we know that there's a shield. There's a shielding process, okay? That means that when you look with a telescope to the human eye to these planets, you won't see the colonization of these people. Are you aware of a shield that sits around these planets that stop the actual ability to be able to visually see what's happening on the outside? Are you aware of this?
Not in the terms of a giant energy shield. Okay, so the Ceres colony.
Like a cloak, right?
Well, they did have holographic stuff that covered like the doors to the bay. There was a huge hologram that would turn on. And I didn't see that with my own eyes, but that's what I was told. That's what I remember being told. There was a hologram that would pop up over it. But everything was underground. And what's going on is the satellite technology and our telescopes that are looking up at the moon, they are computer. In other words, okay, so if there's a telescope that look like the Hubble telescope can look at the moon, and you could see plenty on the moon if you did turn it there, but it's the scope is meant to look at darker objects than the moon is bright, so it would hurt the camera. It's a computer. It's computerized. So when the Hubble looks at a classified satellite, and they don't want people that have access to the Hubble to know the orbit of a military satellite, I'm giving you an example. The computer just strikes it out and puts black there. It's
the
automatically
same,
done.
Same as it does.
Nobody
on
sees it.
The same
nobody
as it does
presses
on
a button.
Google Earth with Antarctica, that's just white, and all the entrance to all the hollow Earth plate is all just covered up white.
Yeah, and there's not a guy in a lab somewhere doing it. It's the computer.
It just automatically
does it. So that's what's going on. So when the Hubble looks at Saturn or Jupiter, and there's air traffic around Jupiter, the computer is deleting it faster than we can see it. It's not a guy. All the telescopes have this technology built into them. It's military-based stuff because the military says, look, we have classified satellites. You don't need to know where it is. So we're going to access your software. We need to have a little discussion with your software.
So that's
what that is.
That's not
real time censorship.
That's not good. We're going away, man. And me and you can do this really easily, right? Let's pull it back.
So you're talking about a bigger shield. So there are shields now. This is what I've learned that I don't remember from my experience out there, but I've learned after. But there are shields that block the radio signals. EMF blocking shields.
We're going to talk offline about this, Tony, because I've got some stuff to tell you, and I'm not telling you this online. So we'll talk. Let's get back. Let's go back to. I want to talk about this Hollow Earth is really important to me, and I believe that this is really important to not just me. This is important to everybody that live as a being on this Earth. What's important to me right now is to understand whether or not the Germans and our elite, these five families and the network behind these five families, this cabal, have gone underground and have created their own re-existence of a world, which means that when they destroy our planet, they'll go inside our planet. And for them to have that ability to be able to do that and be able to not tell every single living human being on this Earth that there is the ability to be able to live inside this Earth, I think, again, it's another mockery, right, Tony? So I'd like for you to explain to me what you saw. So take me from when you went in your ship, you went under the water, and then you're going into Antarctica.
Well, I didn't see much. But okay, so the ship, when we were underwater, they would tell us, you know, we're going to be underwater. And there was no danger or anything. I guess the anti-grav field around the ship makes the water weightless as well, right against the ship. So it just pushes it out of the way, and then
I know that, yeah.
Well, and then water doesn't flex, so it would just push the water out of the way and go. I don't know exactly how it worked, but it flexed the hull of the ship, and it would pop. It would make popping sounds, pow, pow. Every now and then you'd hear like a metal flex, and it was terrifying. I was terrified of it, you know. But we weren't in danger or anything. It was more than once. But there were times when we stepped out, and it was like 55 degrees inside, under the ice. There was a dome of ice in Antarctica where we dropped off, and it was like 55 or 60 degrees. God, I'm not saying it right. I remember that what it felt like, but I don't remember the measurement because they told me in Celsius, and I don't know Celsius that well. But it felt like it was like 50 to 55 degrees. It was cool. You could see your breath, but it was warm. It was warm enough to walk around. You didn't need a heavy jacket kind of thing. Like, you could get used to the cold. I had definitely been many way colder places. And I remember looking up at the ice, like way up. I remember looking at the ice thinking, how is that not melting and being flooded? And it was kind of wet in there. But apparently they said there was thousands of years of ice worth of melt. Like at the rate the ice was melting because of the heat, the temperature, it was a volcanic thing that was keeping the temperature that made the pocket. And they said there would be 1,000 years till the ice melted. You know.
And you mentioned to me that were the Germans that colonized there. The Germans then, and this is how we. I think this is where we're going to move forwards now. Is that what we've done is that we've got some clarity, right? So I'm going to reference a film, and both of us liked it, and that's Iron Sky. Okay, and this is going to flip us back to the previous interview and take us forward into part two, really into part two now, right? So. We talked about Iron Sky and we talked about Tongue in Cheek and how disgusted I was. And you know, we both had a laugh, right? Now, you've just clarified something for me that tells me that it's real. And this is why you said to me that it was so close to the truth, that film. But it was tongue in cheek and everything wasn't the same. But the sheer theory of what the film represents is a real reality. A real reality. Yeah. And but by the clarity that you've given me, first of all, we've gone into Inner Earth. So for the listeners of Esoteric Disclosure, we've not done videos on Inner Earth, Antarctica, anything yet, and we're going to. And this is a great foundation for us to work on, Tony, to bring that into reality, right? And okay, so then let's go from being in Inner Earth and knowing that that Germans have colonized Antarctica under the ice, and we go to where's the first place that you were taken from when you left Earth, when you was in Seattle, then you went and traveled, and then you was this drug guy that made listened on the cargo with a
cargo ship. That's it. It was an airplane.
Airplane, sorry.
Peru. Okay.
So where's the first place you were taken out of this Earth? Where did you land? Where was the first place?
It was on the moon. There was a base on the back of the moon, the trapezoid base.
What we call the dark side of the moon.
It was on the dark side of the moon. And what happened was I went through another bout of the mind programming. And
when you landed?
I didn't land. I mean, it was kind of... They also had... There were times on the moon and in transit when they could like put us in a mode. They could blink you out where I kind of spaced out and just walked around where they told me to. And I don't remember what I was doing.
This is the hypnotic programming that they've done through the videos that enable them to be able to switch in and out of.
Exactly. They could put you in a mode. Just stand there. You'd stand and kind of be out of.
Click. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So this happened while she was in the ship. But you remember you landed on the moon. When you landed on moon in the trapezoid base, is this still the Germans?
Yes. I want to say yes. They were blonde people there.
Blonde.
And then there were greys, the taller greys there.
Evans, they've been referred to, right?
I don't remember the name exactly, but they were the greys.
And just whilst we get on greys, did you experience the taller greys and the shorter greys, which are the androids that work for the bigger greys? Did you experience this?
Yeah.
And this was on the moon. You experienced this on the moon. Now.
When they first took me, it was shorter ones working on me, and a taller one came in for a minute and checked up and left. He was like the doctor one. And then when they put me back, there were shorter ones working on me.
They're the fucking androids.
And the taller one worked on the computer on the wall. He had a computer station.
The little ones are the androids. You know that. They're the robots, right? You know that.
Yeah, they were not.
Grace.
They did not engage me in any kind of communication. They were like, they were robotic. I thought they were real people at the time, but they were very unemotional. There was no. It was unromotic. They did not care. And then there was a reptilian. There was a short reptilian there, too.
That I saw that you communicated with, that I watched on another video, that you had the conversation with, etc. And we'll do that later, right? And we've discussed this, and I don't want to touch on that because it's there. Let's talk about being on the moon. Go.
So what they did was, it was a big room, and they would plug us in. They'd give us eye drops, some drugs, and they'd do the binaural stuff. We had not a headphone, but it was kind of like a place, like I would sit and be... put your chin on something and there were two speakers close by, and they did the binaural, and then for 5 minutes, and then that quit, and then it was a class, and it was about fight or flight response, and it was movies of combat, and then programming movies with subliminal stuff in there, and then like weird noises, and it was over and over again of if you get into violence, then you stay there and defend your brother, you know, your family, your friends on your team are your brother and family, you will defend them, it's better to defend them and die for your family than to, you know, and that, it was like over and over again for all day for weeks on end.
This is mind conditioning to put you into combat, right?
It was fight or flight response, exactly. They were programming us to not flight in violent.
I get what it is.
And so that was my military training. That was it. They didn't tell you really I didn't get any how to field strip the gun or any of that stuff. None of that. How to operate radio, nothing. There was no, it was fight or flight response to it. And there were other cues, I'm sure there were other commands in there that they put, like how to zonk out when I'm standing around and do nothing. But, and then they would take me back, they would spray me down they'd spray me down soaking wet, naked, and throw me in my room. I had a room.
On the moon. And
with some crappy, like a pasty food, like a oatmeal, like a gross food.
Was you inside the moon, or was you on the base, on the top of outside?
It was on the surface, and I think, you know, I may have been downstairs or whatever. I didn't know where I was in the building. At the very end of everything, I finally got to a room with a window. At the very, very end of everything, later, I finally looked out a window, and it was dark, so I didn't see much of the moon. But I remember that whole time in the moon, I never got to look out a window.
So what we're saying here is that I'm starting to build a picture, right? And it seems to me as though it's almost as though there's a, we know it's called a program, right? The 20 and back program. But it seems to me that there's a clear, concise message that stands out here. We go back to the Second World War and we talk about the draconians owning the Germans, right? And we talk about the ability for them to be able to control our race all the way back to 75,000 years ago, when we say that our consciousness came from Mars here because Mars became inhospitable, right? So then we jump back forward and we come all the way here and we get back to the Germans and the reptilians, and then we talk to you and we see films and we get programming about the moon and then being colonized by the Germans again, and then we hear stories of Greys and Greys working in affiliation with certain races to be able to develop, and then we hear that there were bloody lizards, draconian lizards on the moon with the Germans, right? And yes, with the Greys. And who else? And
there was, okay, so the base, I don't know if I went, when they took me out of my house and into a base where they worked on me originally, I don't know if I was on the moon or not, but where that was, the room was rounded, that very first stop, there were insectoids there too. Because I remember I was excited and I was happy about discovering ETs. And I asked them, how many different ETs are, how many different species are here? And they said, look, there's one there. Did you see? I said, well, I can't see that far. I don't have my glasses. They said, that was an insectoid. Too bad you didn't see him. Those are neat looking. You know, like they were telling me, the reptile was telling me this. And he said, there's a lot of different ones. So
in the other video, you said the reptile guy lived in his own planet. He had his girlfriend. I saw all
this. He said he went home. He went home to his own world every day. At the end of the day, he went home to his planet. It was a short commute for him. He commuted back to his planet.
I'm happy for you to say the name of the channel that you talked about these species on. Do you remember?
Oh, I don't know. I've done it quite a bit, quite a few.
Don't worry. I'll post that in the comments for you guys to be able to see the video for Tony. I'm quite happy to share other people's stories, right, Tony? It's absolutely fine. Other people's channels. Okay, look. So I think we've covered Mars and Moon. And have you been inside the Moon? Did you go inside the Moon? Are you aware that you can go inside the Moon?
Right. There were different, you know, I've never talked about this openly, and these are things that I, there's a whole episode of things I remember that I kind of was in denial of. And there was a separate base on the moon that was lower, that was like, what do you call it? High security clearance. And there was a mission I did years later, after I went to Mars, after I went to Ceres. I was there 4 or 5 years on Ceres, and I volunteered for a mission and came back and did a mission that was at a classified underground base on the moon.
And was there massive satellites under there?
I didn't see any of that. I always rode in the bottom of the ship with no window or nothing. And when we got there, you walk out and like an umbilical comes up and joins to the ship, just like on an airplane when you get off the airplane. And so that's what I saw. I didn't really get to look out. And then they took us to another base on the moon and they tested us in combat with a bug, and with a giant bug.
With a what?
With a giant insect.
with a what, sir?
Yeah. It was a giant bug. It was probably 400-500 pound spider. And they put us in a room with it and they tested us out to see if we would suicide. They gave us an explosive and one of us did and went up and it worked and they were happy. And we stayed the night there and we went to a medical area, like a military medical bay. And then we just slept in those cots that night. We got the next morning and got on a ship, a big ship, and went to Mars. And we were there quickly, but we did not have security clearance, or the airspace wasn't clear for us to land. So we stayed in orbit around Mars like 2 hours. It was a long time. And we had to stay in our seats. It was supposed to be a short flight, and it ended up being, you know, hours. But then we landed, and I was immediately taken off that ship through a short hallway onto a smaller ship and then flown to a base that was in a remote area. So they took us to it was a forward base. And I guess the history of the base was that it had been overrun by the bugs at one point and was abandoned. And so it was a place that could hold like 200 people, but there were only 50 people there. So there was a lot of empty areas, a lot of empty rooms and things. And everything could accommodate way more people than what was there. It was like an empty, walking through an empty school. You know, it was like that. And there were levels underground. I remember when we landed, there was a hangar thing, and we got out, like an indoor, and we landed, and we went to the upper level had like an armory and a hospital, and then the second level had a more hospital, I think, and then we were all the way down, like five levels down, or seven levels down, and it was basically, when you got out of the elevator, there was a cafeteria area, and it looked like a school. It looked like a modern day, you know, junior high school, kind of the architecture of it. And in the middle was a cafeteria, and then it branched off and everything was color-coded. There were colors along the wall, and it went out into like four or five different areas. And there was an office area, like office cubicles, a big room with cubicles, and they had converted and put cots in there rather than office desks, and that's where we slept. They put us all in one of those, and we had a, right across the hall was a bathroom. You know, like a public bathroom.
Dude, you were like 12 now, right?
No, yeah. I was more like 17 or 18 at this point.
Okay, fine.
Oh no, I was 16 or 17. Okay. I would say, and, you know, and I say it all the time. It's not like they celebrated my birthday.
So the time spent was the time that was spent when you were in Seattle, and all the time that you were in the States. This time took up from 12 to like 15, 16, right? And that's when you went off to the moon and to Mars.
So I was taken, and then I went to Peru. So I would have been 10, 11, 12, going on 13 to Peru, and then 14 and 15, and going on 16, Seattle, and then 16 to Mars, and 17 till 28 on Ceres.
Okay, let's go. Okay, let's go. So we're in Mars. What you're telling me is that, so from what your knowledge of Mars and the colonization that's happened on Mars, is this all on top surface or is this inside Mars? What's your knowledge of this?
Everything was well hidden. Most of the stuff was well hidden. They try to hide it well. I think that's for a few reasons. I think they try to hide it for us looking at it, and I think they hide it from each other. I think that Mars at the time, and probably still does, has a complicated political system. And there are other species living there. So it's not like you put your buildings up where everybody can see where they're at. They, you know, they dig in. And I think it's just better, you know, you're talking about being airtight and climate controlled environment. You put it underground. But these
did
were combat.
Did you walk on the surface?
I did, yep.
And what's the atmosphere like?
It felt like you could breathe. And I think that I may have had a surgery or something. They gave me a surgery at some point to make it easier to breathe there. I think there was an enhancement, but it's a guess. But I could breathe. And we had a suit, that we had an environmental suit. We didn't get combat armor. The soldiers had armor, which was neat because it weighed them down and they were zero buoyancy. So they could run just like, they walked and ran just like they were on Earth because their suit was heavy. So they weighed the same as they would on Earth because of their suit. But our suit was a lot lighter, so we kind of struggled when we ran. We were kind of bouncy.
But anyhow,
it was a suit and it was open, but it had it was like a hat that, you know, like a white hood that went in. You know, it was flexible, and then it had a plastic cone like right here. And every so often, the suit knew when I exerted myself, and it would give me oxygen, but it would last a long time. A small canister of oxygen, it was just a puff here and there when I was exerting myself, and so that way it would last a lot longer. It was an environmental suit, and then it kept me warm, and it gave you shots. There were three shots that it would give you in combat if you got hurt or whatever. Stimulant that would make the pain go away and make you have like adrenaline for about 4 minutes, 3 or 4 minutes.
So Secret Space Program, you were enrolled in the Secret Space Program from the point that you were taken by the Greys and started to be tested on. That's your enrollment. Through this period of time now, and I know that there was a Dark Force element that we can talk about maybe later that you worked for right at the end. At the moment in this place, it sounds to me that we're at your very early stages of your training and your programming before you're actually put out into service, right? And
well, that case, from that base, we did hiking missions. We did three combat missions. And what it was they had guys like me that were slaves, and we were support soldiers. We were doing bounty maneuvers, and the real soldiers that had armor, they had the real technology. They knew what they were. They knew where they were. They had all the information. You know, they were in the Iron Man suit, and we were in an environmental suit. We were in, we walked in the middle, and they walked hidden. And I think that they would wait for the bugs to come and try to engage us, and then open fire on them. I think it was just a standard bounding maneuver. And I think that the program was trying to get numbers. You know, rather than having a soldier that was a complete badass that they trained and spent all this money on training for United States soldiers. And, you know, we were walking around we had lunchtime. They hazed us. They picked on us for being, you know. But we had three missions, and what happened was the bugs adapted to the strategy much faster than they thought than they were supposed to. And they canceled the program. So we sat there like 6 weeks and did nothing. I had literally nothing to do. We laid in our cots all day with nothing. No entertainment. Zip. And it was really boring. But then I was taken, and now this is when I was taken to that dome. When we finally were left out of there, they took us to a city that was both military and civilian.
This is a city under the earth in a dome.
And we flew into a hangar bay. We flew high altitude on a small ship. You could see out there was a window, but I couldn't really see much. It was cloudy, you know. But we flew at a high altitude and maybe 30 minutes flight, and then we landed, and we got out in a hangar and went in. And there was an officer there that guided us, and it was myself, and they split us up. And it was myself and only like four other guys that walked in and said, "You're coming with me. And, you know, you guys are with me. Those guys are going that way." It was an officer. He took us in. And this was when you opened up. It was like, "Welcome to Mars Colony, the most advanced colony in the solar system." That's when you heard that. And it was a big geodesic dome. And you could see through it, but it was dirt. It was covered in dirt. And at the very top, you could see the sky. And you could see dirt blowing across it. Like, it was windy. And you could see dirt on the top. It was dirty. But the dome itself was buried under the dirt. and the very top of it was open to the sky. You know, the whole dome was glass. And then inside there were palm trees. There was a water feature.
Was it glass waterfall? Was it glass affected? Did you actually go and touch this?
I didn't touch it. No, no.
What you saw?
I can't say it was made of glass. It was clear.
Yes. And I wanted to get that across. Is that I don't believe it probably was glass, and that's not me shitting on you. But it's like that's what it came across to you like this, a severe type shape that was like glossy, right? That's shiny.
Well, no, it was clear. It was clear.
Totally clear.
When you got to the middle of it and sat down, which is where there was a water feature. There was a water, like a pond with a little waterfall and sprinkler, you know, and there were palm trees there. And there was a bench. And he said, you guys sit here and wait. And we waited there a long time. We were there like an hour or more, better. And he went to a window and there was a girl there that was like a resort. It looked like checking into a resort is exactly what it was. Where we came in off from the hangar bay, where we were
palm trees and water.
Yeah, but when you looked up at the top, you could see the sky, and I could see there was dirt on it. You know, like
so
dirt.
When
had
you saw
up.
The sky, what did you see?
It was just a super light blue sky. You know, up there.
It's like normal, right?
Yeah. Well, it was lighter. No, it was much lighter than. It was a lighter blue. Yeah. But it was blue.
So what was this dome then? And you said it's like a hotel, like you were checking into a hotel. So let's go through this process.
He told us to wait there. He said, you guys wait there, do not move, and they're going to send somebody over to get you, and you'll go with them and do what you're told. And then he left. And we sat there and waited. I don't know how long.
Who was this, a German?
He was an officer. I think he was an American officer, if I had to guess. He was in a formal military suit. He wasn't in a soldier's, you know, suit. He was in a more formal looking dress. Okay.
When you looked around in that dome, Tony, what did you see? Was there other races of people? Was there
just people? No, there was just humans, and they were coming and going. And there was a place to eat. There was a food area, but we were told not to move anywhere. And like I didn't even get up and go to the bathroom. I did what I was told, you know.
The sound of it, you did what you told pretty much all the way through this because you were pretty fucking petrified by the sounds of it. Sorry for my French viewers.
Yeah, no, well, no, they actually went. No, that's true. They actually gave us programming at one point. After my service on Ceres, they put me through another round of programming that induced fear.
They told me
straight to my face, you're going to get programmed to be afraid. Because it was easier to control that, you know. It was like they induced it, and the other people on the ship were like, they would pick on me because they knew that every little thing would make me afraid, you know. Like they knew that this was something they did to their slaves because they induced fear so that every little thing that ever happened, you'd be afraid of it.
Yeah, so you conform. So you conform. You do what you want.
Exactly right. You're not thinking for yourself.
But dude, this is a perfect relation to what every stupid. And I don't want to call people stupid on earth, but every soul that is in a body that is on this earth that is being led by fear and greed, and it's just disgusting. And what you're saying is exactly what the Germans and the Draconians have been doing to us.
Yes.
Forever.
Well, and you know what?
Go on. Listen.
And now, on a side note, the whole fear thing. That's why all the movies are mega violent. That's the whole reason. You can see. I can turn on the TV right now. And flip the channel not even five times and find somebody getting shot to death. But you can't find anybody kissing. You know, you're not going to find people falling in love. You're not going to find people winning or doing well. But you can find some violence pretty damn quick. And that's because subconsciously your brain identifies like it's really happening and it causes a state of fear. That's the whole thing. The more TV you watch, the more scared you are.
I'll tell you one thing. So happy about, right? So we're going off on a tangent a little bit, and we'll come back.
Right. Sorry.
No, it's me and you, dude. Don't worry. And I want to share something with you. So when I was really, since I've been really young, I've had this real issue with reading textbooks and reading books on this planet, right? And I've had this feeling ever since I was so young that it's all a waste of fucking time. The books are not meant to be read, right? I've had this feeling, and then. What's the guy, Tomkinson, the guy that came out? Yeah. And he's come out and he's gone, every single textbook that every single PhD student has read, those textbooks are all a lie. When you know those moments like you said when you woke up, that was another moment for me where I was like, ah, I knew I shouldn't have read.
A lot of people paid a lot of money to get lied to like that. Think about that.
And I knew, listen, my guys have been with me for a long time, right? And I don't even realize they were with me when I was younger. And I just know that there was a voice and I didn't know what the voice was, right? And I just used to follow the voice, man. And I used to trust the voice. And it's not done me too bad, Tony, as we stand. Anyway, listen, let's get back. We've been on Mars now. We've gone into a base. We've gone out on one mission. The insectoids have learned and over. And I'm assuming that means
there were three missions that I went on. There were more.
I'm assuming this is a great war, man. I'm assuming it's not one war, but there are many wars with many species on Mars, right? And it's not. Is it an ever-ending battle that you're always in? That all these species are always in on this planet? Because we know Mars as being a war planet, right?
Honestly, I don't know a lot about the only what others have told me. My experience there was I only had contact with the bugs. We only had contact with the bugs. And you know what? Maybe the whole bug episode is something that you would refer, so we don't waste a lot of time on it. But you would refer another one of my, like you said, another link to one of my interviews that where I talked about that whole bug war, the whole fight.
I think you're right.
Because that's a long thing. It's a lot of detail, you know. But I only had contact with them. Everybody says there's reptiles there too, but I'd never met a reptile on Mars because I was tasked.
You met the tall white, the tall blonde, what could be sort of tall blonde figures there in Mars. And what other species did you meet on Mars? We're going to just cover this and we're going to go to Sirius. Go on.
Well, the bugs. I mean, I was in a combat mission with the bugs. I got injured and I met one of the mantids.
Let's do the mission where you got injured, Tony. Let's do that one mission, right? That's what I was saying.
This is a time eater, but we went out.
Make it quick then, Tony. Don't dwell.
Okay. We went out on I'll go quick. We were doing hikes and we got separated. There were six of us and there were two soldiers. The two soldiers went along a mountain crest and we were out on a flat plain. And we started getting away from them, and three of us wanted to stay within range of the soldiers, and myself and two others wanted to stay according to the plan that they told us to do. They gave us a map, and they said, you go that way. So we split up, which was against the rule, against orders. And at that point, it got clouds blew in. It got really windy. The weather turned crappy, and there was low visibility, and we got engaged by the bugs. And there were short beetle kind of bugs. There were the bigger spider ones, and there was a one mantid.
It beat your armor.
And the mantid didn't. It was the spider one, and we got the other two guys died, or got eaten up. I don't know if they had survived, but they died. And we were engaged. The soldiers came and rescued me, and I was scanned or probed or whatever by the mantid. He did a psychic thing. And
did you say a mantis?
A mantid, yeah, a mantid one.
Wait, I'm not hearing what you're saying.
A mantid.
What's that?
It looked like a big praying mantis. But anyhow, he looked up my history. He showed me my life, and he wanted to know our purpose because we were a new thing on the battlefield. And so he was there to study us. You know, that's why he even came out. I guess it was rare for a mantid to come out. And he studied me and to find out what I was. And he let me live. He was able to let me live. And the soldiers came and rescued me. We put on auto tourniquets. I had my arm bit off and my foot, my
what
right foot.
What was that experience with that mantis that let you live, dude? Have you talked about this already?
Yeah, I have. Well,
that's interesting to me. What was the interaction? Was it telepathic or was it?
He came up to me. He had antennas, right? And so it's your typical whatever cliche alien stuff. But he did. He had antennas. And they were when he walked up to me slowly, and when he got close, the antennas were kind of like randomly moving. And when he got close, he went, and they kind of went,
oh shit!
And I was in a dream state. I totally lost consciousness. I went into a whole nother.
So he homed into you, and he fucking tuned
no pain.
Into you.
Right, yeah. I was in pain. I was in shock. I was injured. I had my arm bit off at that point, and I was in a complete state of shock. and I was begging it, don't kill, please don't kill me, please don't kill me, when it did that. And then I went in, and then it was, I was standing in the room in Inyokern at that classroom. I was standing there, and it was empty, and it was me standing there, and the mantid was there.
You know what he's done?
What?
You know what he done? He scanned looking, your mind, and he wanted to know where it was that you came from. Yeah, it's obvious, right?
Well, he went through there. He showed we. Then we went to the house in Seattle.
He
we went
to
he scanned where I was, and then at the very end of it, it was my living room that I was taken, the house I was taken from, which I didn't remember.
He made a conscious choice to let you live, and that was based on the information that he took when he looked back.
He took me. I was sitting in my old living room with a farmhouse where I grew up, and I had no memory of it at the time. He said, "This is where you are. This is who you are." That's what he said. This is who you are.
That's why he let you live, Tony.
Yeah, and he said you can live. And then boom, I woke up and I was back to being. So the pain was back.
They rescued you. Yeah, and then let's talk about what happened with your arm quickly. Let's hit that piece just before we move on.
I was losing consciousness the whole walk back, and he kept slapping me. They ran out of injections to give me to keep me awake, and the painkillers, and they ran out of those, and it was like something like 4 kilometers to walk. And I had tourniquets on, and he kept slapping me to keep me awake. And as soon as we saw the door to the base, he let me fall asleep, and I passed out. And when I woke up the next morning, I had my arm and my foot back.
And did it feel? Listen, I know factual now that there is the ability, and we have the ability to be able to 3D print organs limbs and organs. This is a reality. It's being hidden from us. I know it's being hidden from us. I know that we've only just had 3D printing released to us, but I know this can happen, dude. Like, but when I heard you say that on that video, I didn't go, oh my God, they regrew his arm. Like, dude, of course you can fucking regrow organs.
A lot of people, it's the hardest thing. They're like, come on, man, you should know something more than what you know. But honestly, I passed out when I saw the door.
I woke up,
and they didn't have to explain anything to me. When I was laying in the hospital bed, I still felt groggy the next morning. They debriefed me. There were 2 officers there, and they sat and asked me questions for 30 minutes. And what did they say to you? What was going on? What happened? You were alone with that man for a minute. What happened? And he told me to tell them that we're not that stupid. That was his message. He said, make sure you tell him we're not this stupid.
We're not going to tell him anything, dude. He said, you're not the one that's going to take information from the mantis. The mantis took the information from you, dude. Like,
right. Well, and I said, they said, well, what did he say? And I said, he told me to tell you that they're not this stupid. that's all I know. And I told him everything else. You know, I was open about it. And that was my debriefing. That was the debrief. Okay. And so I got up, and they gave me breakfast, and I went and joined the rest of the people. And then I was taken. So, hey, I want to get to that point. So from that room, the dome room, somebody finally came and got us, and they took me down, and I got my own room. I had my own bed. They had my own toilet in there. Mars had really fancy. They had the they had the bidet, you know, like water.
Well, you didn't get toilet. Like this. Didn't get like the Japanese and the
yeah, it was like that, right? It was like that. The room was awesome. It was plush. I had a nice bed. I had a nice area that I slept in. But then they would come and get me in the morning. An officer would come and knock on the door, and he was not an officer. He was more like a soldier. A soldier would come and get me and take me to a big classroom. And it was testing, and it was the same system. It was the same thing with the binaural and then a screen and. I didn't have to press anything. You keep your hands down or your hands, you know. And what you did was the screen would break up into 4 sections. It would ask you a question. You would see a video, and then it would ask 4 questions. You just had to look at the answer for a second and go, Haile, is this your answer? You just look at it again and go, yes. And that was how the testing worked. And I got and it was like months of it. And
who
I went through.
They tested you, Tony.
They tested me. First, I got tested. There was a gray there. It was another tall. It was a tall, whiter gray, and he was our teacher.
What stands out to me, and from the research that I've done, is that these tall grays are very advanced, man. Very, very advanced, and very Well, I've seen some things about the Greys being us in the future, dude. I've seen some stuff about that. But anyway, look, let's talk. So carry on. So the Greys were testing you, the binary stuff.
It was a command test, and I failed. And then, so then it was like, not command, but like communications, and then I failed. And then it was engineering, and I failed. It was, you know, they went through tiers of labor, and he kept saying, like, he was, you know, like an abrasive teacher. He would always have remarks like, don't fail this one. You know, he would come up and say, don't fail this one. If you know what's good for you. Yeah, it was all telepathic. There were no words, but it was telepathic. It's just,
it had a humor, right?
It wasn't humor, though. It was more like abuse, but you know what I mean? But he would say, if you know what's good for you, you'll pass this one, but I'm sure you won't because you're stupid. You know, he didn't say it like that, yeah. But he was kind of like...
Super... What I got from you this time was it was more of a condescending nature.
He was very condescending, exactly. He was
not
very
so much humor, more as in, I'm better than you, right. You're not going to be...
Towards the end, he was like, I can't believe you missed that one by one. You missed that by one. You would have qualified. And it was a good job. It was like, I forget what it was, but it was like, it would have been a good job. I would have got that job. He said, look, you got to pass this. You missed the last one by one. You should pass this one. And if you don't, the only thing left for you is hard manual labor. And you're going to finish out your time. You're going to do a decade or more of hard labor. So you need to pass this test. You're not giving it your all. That's what he said.
Did it again?
I passed that test, and it was skilled labor. It was skilled labor. And he said that I passed it only by a couple points. He said, you should have aced this one because you barely missed the last one. But I passed it, just barely. And what that put me in was ship repair. And I started learning. It was like movies about fire, what happens when a fire, what to do if there's a fire that breaks out on the ship, what to do, like protocols on what to do stuff. And then it was procedures on how to fix things. And how, it was procedures on not the actual skill of fixing things. It was a procedure on how to learn how to fix the thing with the system. How to look up things on the system.
I understand. It's like
how to do what I was told.
It's like today with a modern day mechanic, you go and plug the computer into the ECU, and the computer says, "Go and change part number 36." And you take number part 36, and it says, "Put number part 36 to number 37 and 38, and then fix it together with this screwdriver."
Exactly what it was like on a huge level, and it was like a submarine ship. But that's exactly what it did every morning.
Is this William Tompkins? I don't know why. I've watched probably fucking 10 hours of the guy. So William Tompkins was saying that he was building these submarine ships, and that is this relative? So let's just come out of where we are, and let's talk a little bit about ships, right? So Tony Rodriguez is this guy now that is a qualified guy to be able to go and do ship maintenance and look after ships, right? So
right.
That means that we're going to go and talk about your journey from that point on. And obviously that's the point of when you started to be working in the cargo ships and traveling, right? And that's when you moved to Sirius. And I'm assuming Sirius will be your base. We'll talk about that later. Just talk to me about these ships, man. Sirius. Sorry, dude. Yeah.
Sirius. So... Yeah. You know, we got up in the morning, it was like a prison, you know, a bunch of 500 guys got up and we went through a shower, and then there was a little cafeteria you could eat. They came and got me. It was another guy, an older guy came and got me, and he said, and I was walking towards the school area, and he said, no, we're going this way. Come on. And we walked to a very, like a beautiful train area. And it was a white and blue train that pulled up, and there were hundreds of people there, and everybody boarded. It was busy, and they were talking about that it was expensive, that it was hard to get on this train, and it had. Now I rode many trains through the experience.
This is on Mars now.
Mars, yes.
And you're going to get the train to planet Sirius.
I want to explain how the experience was.
I want to understand it, dude, because
yeah. So I got on, and these were people, everybody was dressed well. There were people in, you know, it was like a well-dressed, you know, affluent-looking crowd. And the guys were talking, the one guy was like happy. It was just like being on an airplane where everybody talks to each other. It was that kind of culture. So, and I've been on a lot of trains, and I want to get this right, but I'm pretty sure that this train had a bar that dropped down like a roller coaster. Like you sat in the seat, the seats were facing forward, and it had a bar that came down on your lap. Instead of a seatbelt, it was just a bar that came on your lap. That was it. And the train, when they turned it on, they closed the doors, everybody was on, and when they turned it on, you could feel it hop up. It hovered. It went whoop when they turned it on. And it was smooth. It wasn't rolling on anything. It was smooth. And it took off and went into a tunnel. And halfway, you know, after it got up to speed, you could feel like you were accelerating. And then there was a poof, like a poof, you know. And it was disorienting. I was dizzy. I was slightly dizzy.
You know, you went for a time portal, right? You know,
I don't know. Like I said, it was a poof. It was a disorienting poof. I don't know what happened.
Support.
At the time, but here's what happened after that. The train immediately started decelerating. That's the thing. Like, you were accelerating, and then you got the speed, then poof. I mean, it hit you quick. It was.
So it's either light speed. It's either light speed or into a portal. It's one of those two things for that feeling to happen.
Well, and then it started. It came onto another track, and it's decelerated, and we stopped. And then it went down. It stopped. You know, like it was floating, and then it stopped and rolled in. And
what was the time lapse between the time of
5 minutes? Not even 5 minutes. It was quick.
So
I'm like, wow, we're already stopping. And when we got out, they were giving everybody water. You had to give water. So it was a portal, and you had to rebalance your electrolytes afterwards.
It's definitely a portal, dude.
So they were giving everybody water, and me, because of my rank I held, they just gave us the little cup of water. It's one. I was dying of thirst at that point, and they gave one little cup of water. That's enough for you to stay alive and go over there. And it was a giant hangar room full of Nazis.
This is where they said, welcome to Sirius.
Welcome to Sirius. You're on the most advanced colony in the solar system. Exactly. The same thing they told me on Mars. And a lot of people took off and went their way, and there was an officer. There was a guy, and now this guy was armed. The soldiers there had firearms.
So you've gone up. I just want to say you've gone a step further. So you've gone from Germans to Nazis, dude. So now.
Well, I'm saying. I mean, I'm not gonna. I don't know. You know, they were Germans, but they were.
Dude, did they wear the swastika on their fucking on their arms?
Yes.
So then they're Nazis.
Eagle. They always had an eagle. There was always sometimes they had a different symbol under the eagle, but it was always an eagle with something around it. And
definitely the Nazis. Definitely.
They were talking in German, and it was straight up. Just like it was the military, you know, it was a military.
Stepped
out of
compound.
A civilian area into a military area.
Military compound? Military.
Yes.
Right. And so this is when you arrived. Let's just get this right. This is the star system Sirius.
No, it's in our solar system.
And it's called
Ceres. Ceres. The planet right. Ceres. And it's a planet, it's a dwarf planet right after Mars, in between Mars and the asteroid belt. It's a little planet right there. It's only 580 miles in diameter. It's a small place. It was the planet Ceres. And this is where the O'Connor crater has that.
Sorry, can you just say from there, just say it's the planet, because it broke up a little bit, Tony. Sorry, dude. Can you just say it's the planet Ceres and just say the size and everything about it again?
It's the planet Ceres. It's a dwarf planet in between Mars and the asteroid belt. And it's about 580 miles in diameter. It's a small planetoid. And what it is they found a base there, apparently, found a base there that was abandoned. The Germans moved into it and began building. And so there's a real hybrid human-looking architecture from the old days, from like the 40s, architecture built into caverns that were tunneled out by some other race long ago. And they were building into it, and so there were rings around the inside of the planet of train routes, and everything was connected by train. And not the same kind of train like I rode to get there originally, but
I shouldn't think
that's how you got around.
That's interstellar travel. That is that one that you went on. That's an interstellar travel.
Yeah, that could go far, but it was just a hop from Mars to Ceres. It's my personal Dr. Sala. There are things that say that the World War II was a proxy war. Yes. It's my personal belief that World War I was about money, and World War II was about interstellar flight. Like the Germans found it, everybody else found out about it, and war broke out. And the Germans found, and if they didn't stop the Germans when they did, they would have acquired technology. 10 years after the fact, it would have been no contest. So as soon as they found out that the Germans had made contact out there, war happened because, you know, they were gaining speed. Right. And this is different than the history books. I'm not getting this out of the history books.
You're a man that's researched. I'm a man that's researched. We're not guys that are taking this with our eyes closed, right? Our eyes are wide open, man. And you've done a lot of research, and so have I. And our viewers, the viewers of Esoteric Disclosure, and you and I, they'll make their own opinion on this, and that's fine, right? But what we can do is we can speculate. And the reality is, if you look through the human coding, and you look through the messages that are hidden under the mythology of what's happened in our world, and it's pretty easy to identify that the Germans had spaceships. It's not that difficult to go back and find information about the Germans having, and no one else having them, and there being, if you go even further back, and we've already done this once, you even go further back, the Draconians are here, man. The Draconians are in Antarctica. They're under the Earth. They have been for a long time, and they will continue to be for a long time after us. And will we last here? I don't know. But let's carry on.
The thing that I've been researching was the period right before the war. The Germans had spent like an ungodly amount of money searching the world for relics. And so I went back and tried to research that, and there's really no info about where they went. There's an island called Tabatuea. I think the Germans went there and excavated. There's no record of anything that happened there. And there are places around the world, like everybody says the Germans spent all this money to go around the world and excavate, like in, when was that, in the 1900s, in the early 19-teens or 1920s? Right after World War I, I think. Yeah. They had gone around and been collecting artifacts. The Hitler financed this. And there was but I haven't found any records of where they went and where'd they go. So, you know, they went around, they made a lap around the world and collected all the stuff that led to the inner Earth and led to the stuff, because they had been tipped off already by having contact. Right, by having channeling contact. But
they put a lot of money, I believe, into those programs. Like the program that we talked about, Grill Flame, and then the what's this one that we talked about with the Gateway Project, all this type of stuff that we can see. You go look at that document, and it was published in 2003, dude, and written in 96. But if the US military are only writing documents like that in that time, and we're talking about these guys.
Already. And 100 years ago.
Dude.
100 years.
So, yeah. Of course, they're going to be living in Sirius. And let's go back now, right? So, look, let's go back. Let's get back in, Tony. So, we understood now that you've landed in this base. You've taken this train, interstellar train. You've come into this base, and it's got the train systems around it. And you're now in this dwarf planet, right? And we diversified because the Germans came into the play again. And unfortunately, all I hear is this resonating same frequency distortion, whatever you want to call it, of the Germans, right? And it's just going to, every time we talk, we're going to need to cover that off. But we're in this place now. Talk to me about where you are. You've got this military complex. So
what happened was they did that. They did a pledge. We had read our thing, and then they let us off, and we went and got medical examinations. We went to a nearby place and saw a doctor examined us. And then we rode on a train, and I got my room. It took us back to a big place that was like a prison without doors. Imagine a prison cell, like an old, like Alcatraz kind of looking construction, but no bars, like just three walls, three brick walls, you know, maybe a 5x8, you know, and then there was a little cot there and you had to get in a door and there was somebody, there was a guard there. They would buzz you in and buzz you out. That was my home for the next 11 years. And I went there and then they said, well, someone will get you. We'll send somebody for you in the morning. You'll check with the officer.
The interaction that you had the whole time now from these 8 years was all German interaction with soldiers.
Mostly, yeah. Well, I did. The last few years I was there, I did get out into public. Got in the public. But so what happened the next day was that they screwed up. There was a screw up. And they put me on a train to the mines. And I worked one day in the mines as if I was a new guy mining. And they had some kind of beam device that broke up the rocks. It was a beam weapon. And it broke up the, and everybody wanted that one. It was kind of like less work. And then everybody else went in. We just went with shovels and picks and cleared out what they did. It was in low gravity. And then as soon as we cleared out everything, they would be dusty. You know, you had to wear a mask. It was filthy. And then they would build in the gravity plating floor and then move the whole thing in and knock the wall down and repeat. And they just were they were looking for water. But that day when I got back, the police were there and they wanted to, I was going to get punished. You know, like they thought I skipped work. And I said, no, I went exactly where she told me to go. The lady at the window told me to get on the train. So they went and straightened it up. And the next day, I got a whole different suit to wear and different clothes to wear. And I went to the hangar and got into my ship and began that was the first day on the job where I did ship repair.
What was the first ship you got onto? Did you remember what it looked
I'm
like?
I'm dying to remember the name. It was a cool name. I remember I was proud of the name of it. It sounded cool and I just can't, I keep looking, hoping that I'll bump into something that'll jog my memory of that name, but it had a neat meaning, but I can't remember it. And so what happened was I never laid eyes on the ship. When I would take a train and you'd get off the train and there was a big room, like a gymnasium sized room that was stone and concrete. And I got out of the train and then you had an umbilical to go to. There were big numbers and there was a wall with a big door with armed guards there. And the officers entered from that way. So I couldn't go in that way. And there was an umbilical, like just like getting onto an airplane. And you'd walk in the umbilical and I would go in and then take a step deck down. And it was only me and two other guys that worked there. And it was a fairly big area, you know, it was a submarine, but it was kind of, there were spacious areas. There were tight areas and there were doors that we had to step over, you know, and it had the old submarine doors that had the round thing that you could lock the door and a big tall threshold that we'd always trip over.
Stop there a minute. This is going back to the fact that the Germans must have got technology to be able to drive their already existing ground-based technology and be able to fly that technology. So that they take their submarines, they affix a drive to it, and they use it as a spaceship. And that's the same thing as your Bill guy is talking about, Bill Tompkins.
It makes sense because a submarine is already pressurized thing. Can hold the, instead of holding the water out, it can hold the air in.
This goes back to Tompkins, man. And what I think we need to clarify here is, was it like that inside those ships? Was it like number of different levels that was quite skinny, or were they big wide open spaces?
It was skinny. It was just like a submarine, but there were the main room. Okay, so then where I went in the morning, where and two others that worked with me, sometimes there were four of us, sometimes there were, most of the time there were three of us. There in the center of the lower deck where we were, there was a good sized room. It was a good sized room, you know, and there was a screen, a flat screen, and you would go up to it, and we had numbers, so it would say you number, you know, 08421 36, you're going to do this today, boom, this is your screen, and it would move the number over onto the screen, and it would have a list of stuff for you to do. And it would say U2, 287 and 289, and you would go over here, and it had a list of things for them to do. And then you could go back and touch it when you were done. And
what were the jobs?
I think there was. Well, it would tell you what to do. Like, it would tell you exactly what. Like, step one, you're going to be cleaning today. You know, go over this section and everything, and then it would show you a map. And this is section C. This is you. Go here and clean that. And it had. There was a tool crib. There was a room that was all tools. And it would tell you to go to that room and get this, and this, and bring it back here. And I think that there was somebody watching. Like, there was an officer that would watch all of us and tell us what to do. Like, there was somebody inputting stuff on the other side.
And this is where they put you in competition with each other, right, to make you always do better and stuff. And
you know what? That ship wasn't really. They did do that, but I didn't really care to. I didn't really play that game at that point. I'm saying I didn't really work at it. A later, more modern ship that I was on, towards the last 2 years I was there, I wanted to earn more freedoms. I wanted to earn more abilities, and I really worked hard at the competition end of it.
Right now, this was Shell Shock. Strange ship that you're on. Looks like a submarine, but it flies. And you've just got these random jobs to do, right? And so you're cleaning, and what other jobs are you doing?
Well, we would repair stuff that would go bad. Most of everything was in a pipe. There would be wires in a pipe, you know, like piping. When you think about an old submarine, what it looked like. And we had quite often.
This is so close to the things that I've already researched. What you're saying is so close to everything that I've researched, Tony.
There's a Dr. Sala had made a write-up about me, and he said that, to his knowledge, at the time that I spoke about the inner side of it looking like a submarine, was before anybody came forward with the word submarine converted. So I was one of the first ones to say that. So that's one of the that's a shred of proof for me.
The stuff that you're saying to me, you don't make this up. You don't make this up, Tony. Like, there is no reason for you, and this is what people have. When I said about the first video, and I spoke to people, and I've shown them the first video. Every single person I've shown it to, all of them said to me, why the hell would you bother? Why would you bother? What gain have you got to do this? None. No gain.
No.
And that's the truth.